What's up, what's up, what's up? I'm Brandman Sean.
And I'm Kohrey.
And we are back with a special guest. Today we are here with Drew, manager of Joyner Lucas, founder of Tully, an app that helps artists build a lot of things on the back end. Actually, Tully does a lot. We'll have to get into that. There's some details, there's a lot of things that, but overall, like, we're here with an overall just dope individual. Like, one of the unique minds, personally, that I've seen in the music industry that aren't just doing it indie, but are building legitimate business, man. So first, let's just start here, man. Like, dope to have you. You just gave us like a walkthrough through some tour buses. Yeah. Y'all got buses on buses back there, and we get into the numbers in there. So we definitely gonna show all that. But now I just want to sit down and kind of get into some of the details of like how y'all started, real quick, and of course we'll go from there, man. So how did you like link up with Joyner at the beginning? Were you his first manager out the gate or what?
Nah, so he actually had another manager that was Drew. Yeah. And so he was just putting music out and obviously just trying to get heard. This was like 2013-14, you know, at the time. And I discovered him. He had a video where he like wrapped his tour van. It was like a Sprinter, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But like a Ford joint. And he had wrapped his face on it or whatever. And it was like a reaction of him seeing that for the first time. And the video went on WorldStar. It was on WorldStar, so I saw the video on WorldStar. And so I was like, man, I wonder if these guys are any good. Like, I was just curious, because I've always been dibbling and dabbling back and forth in music. It's been like a kind of like a, I'm not a professional in the career, so I haven't got a career to do it, yeah. You know, in any form. But, you know, my passion's there. So throughout the years, I've always just, you know, like tapped in with an artist over here and then tapped in with an artist over here. And so he was like an artist. I was like, oh, I wonder if he's good. I looked it up. It was fire. I heard a record he did called Sometimes. And then he had another joint called Fuck Your Feelings. So he had those two like videos, and like he had the video part down as well. That's what intrigued me, because I saw the videos and
he was already doing that creative video.
Like, he already had the video down, and then, you know, sonically I was like, yo, get rad, like this guy's dope. And so I just reached out. Like, how I reached out though is that was funny too, because I couldn't really get a hold of him, because there was no like just reach me here and like type thing. So what I did was I did a Who Is lookup on the domain for his website.
Oh, you really wanted to find him? That's crazy.
So I typed in the domain, and the info of the register came up, and the phone number was there. Yeah, you know I mean, that actually put me through to Drew. Yeah, and so I hit up Drew and I was like, look, I've got a marketing company, I'm running ads on Facebook, and you know, I've spent a few million dollars by this point, like $2-3 million on Facebook at this time. And I said, I've got things working on there for clients that are spending the money, so I want to see if we can do something for him on the music side, you know what I mean, and see if it works. And so he told Joyner about it, and then that's how me and him pretty much met.
That's dope. I didn't know you were a marketer, you know, starting off back in the day.
That's so how I started.
Was that just artists or anybody?
Nah, I tried it. So what you see Tully right now, that's what I tried to create back in 2005. So I graduated Full Sail.
Yeah.
Real World University, you know. So I graduated from there with recording arts, and was doing like the engineering producing thing. And when I graduated, I was like, I'm not doing this, because everyone was trying to do it. And at that time, to become like an engineer for like, you know, a big label or something, like a Sony, you had to like intern for like fucking mad long. It took like 15 years before you could become like a lead engineer. Shit was, you know, home studios was just becoming a thing. So it was still really early. It was MySpace days. You know what I mean? Yeah, so I was like, man, I'm not doing this. This is a hard road. I saw the technology part of it, which was interesting to me. So I started investing my time into technology. So I try to create what you see with Tully right now, but I try to create like an entertainment networking platform back then. And was just like falling short, you know, because code and all of that stuff was so brand new, like to me, and even probably still brand new at that time, you know, in terms of resources and finding developers and things like that. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, try to set up a platform, failed multiple years, year after year after year. I had figured out how to get people to the site, but I couldn't figure out how to get the site to do what it needed to do. You see what I mean? So that's kind of how the marketing started. You know what I'm saying?
Got you. So it's like, I'm doing this part right, or I might as well do that part for somebody else with different products.
Yeah, exactly. Right, so I knew how to get people there. So in 2012, I quit the website that I was trying to do. I said, I'm not doing that no more. And I went and just set up a marketing company because I figured out how to get traffic to places. So then I started selling marketing services. And then by 2012, 2014, I had already spent, like 2015, I had already spent like $2-3 million on Facebook because Facebook launched their ad platform, I want to say like 2013. And then I was in the UK at that time, and I had a client that was investing a lot of money in ads. And so I was managing the ad spend for that client. So I was like, I was managing it at a low because they gave me such a high budget to just go and do it. And I was like, I'm gonna learn something by just doing this. And I'm already intrigued by it. So I did it, started figuring shit out with the dollars I had to spend. And then as I started figuring that out, I was like, then I became curious to try to apply it to music. So then it was like, all right, now I gotta find somebody I can, you know, try to apply it to.
Got you.
Basically.
That's interesting. Because we always hear as marketers too, like that was the golden age of Facebook ads, like 2013 to 2016 or something like that.
Yeah, all these platforms go through phases. Yeah. So that was like the phase, you had to take advantage of it at that time to receive the benefits of it. And just like TikTok, you had to do it at 2020 when COVID happened to really benefit. You try to be the TikTok artist now, it's like saturated, but 2020, you know what I mean? That was like, it was open game. And then like YouTube Shorts.
Yeah.
That's like the thing right now. You know, and that's by end of year, that's gonna fizzle out and it will be something else, you know? So I think that's a big part like of it. We caught that early. It was good timing.
So we joined and the ads worked out, I guess, right?
Yeah, it was our first way of actually getting to, you know, our first core audience. He hit me up after about 2 months of doing, you know, the ads. And he was like, bro, we tried some radio stuff over here. You know, we hired some consultants to step in and say they can do this and that or whatever. And he goes, I'm not seeing a result from any of it. Like, I can't even measure. Like, I don't even know if it's working or not, really. You know what I'm saying? He goes, but I know every morning I wake up, there's like 200 people in my Facebook Messenger, like in the direct messages at that time, right? Yeah. And he goes, and they're all telling me they discover my shit and they love my shit. And you know what I'm saying? So he was just like, whatever you're doing, bro, just keep doing it because I know that's reaching people. You know what I'm saying? And right now, as an artist, he goes, I just want my shit to be seen and heard. He goes, the worst thing is I craft like some of my dopest shit and someone don't see it. And he goes, that's like the worst feeling as an artist. So he goes, I just want to make sure it's getting seen. So whatever that is you're doing, just keep doing it. And then that's kind of how we built. And then, you know, I would show him the platform and show him how that worked. And then he'd learn from that and he would apply it. You know what I'm saying? And I wouldn't say it would work for everybody because you gotta be able to have that mindset to make that work. You know what I mean? Like you gotta have the mindset to make that work for you. Like even the way from the way he, you know, directs his videos, the way he writes records, like he knows how to put the pieces together, you know, cause he like a director first.
That's interesting because I was gonna ask you, like, what do you feel sets Joyner apart?
Yeah, director first. Like, he filmed first, like, over everything. Like, you know what I mean? He's a really talented, like, people only see the final product. They don't see, like, how he actually does it or what goes into, like, I've seen this guy just come up with something, shoot it, next day it's done, and it's like masterpiece. You know what I mean? And it's like that quick, you know, because he just know. And he edits all his videos too. All right, so he don't have to think about, I've got to shoot mad shit and then figure out what I want to use. He's like, shoot that. I got it. We're done. Because he's the one editing, and so he already know what he wants.
Yeah. Yes. So when you say he's video first a lot of times, is it to the point to where he's sometimes coming up with video treatments before the song is created, and then he's working backwards from there? Yeah, that's crazy. Okay, damn.
So he's writing into a world that already exists, basically.
Yeah, it's super unique. So, you know, and obviously, if we're talking about social, everything's video-driven.
Yeah.
It's not picture-driven. Now, it's video-driven. You know what I'm saying? Especially for music. You know, music's not even audio-driven per se anymore. Right? Discovery's all through video. So him being video-driven, you could see how he can master the art of that, you know? And that's also why he's also like one of those artists that's not like overly like saturated online. He don't just post every single day. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's not that artist. And I think it's because he has like this level of like integrity in what he wants to put out. If that makes sense.
Yeah. He cares about the art.
Yeah.
At the end of the day.
And he, that platform worked for him strictly for that. So he treats that equally as impactful, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know,
I just saw a video he posted within the last week where it's like this one shot and the cameras are going like around him. And it was just like, this is crazy. And to hear you basically saying like he's directing all this, it just puts a whole nother level into what you're saying.
He wanted the whole thing to be a one take. And so, you know what I mean? And you go to the Will concept where he took like all the movies that Will's ever did and green screened all of them.
Oh yeah, okay, yeah, that video.
And was able to write the song where he's including the title of every song without it sounding whack. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, just such an incredible talent, bro. Like, you know, and for me, it's such an honor to be able to like figure something out and then be able to take that talent and apply it and take it to the next level. You know what I'm saying? That's crazy. You know what I mean? Because it's not, for me, it was like, I'm over here spending money on products, like promoting products, like product maybe I don't even care about because my job was just to help the company put the product out. Right. You know what I'm saying? So there wasn't a sense of like, accomplishment. If the instrument, it was all numbers. Hey, I converted at this rate, you know? You got the lead for this cost, you made X amount of sales, you know, this is how much was spent, this is the platform that's working, here's your conversion pixels, you know, tied in, so if you want to retarget them, I got all your tracking set up, you know what I mean? Like, it's all that type of stuff, you know what I mean? Like, it wasn't, there was no, like, huge reward or feeling out of it, you know? So doing it for something like this was, it was definitely, like, a very satisfying feeling.
Artists, managers, there is no way you should ever do a regular pre-save campaign again because Forever Fan has Forever Saves, where a fan could pre-save your music one time and then automatically pre-save every song you ever release after that. That's right, forever. And on top of that, Forever Fan has email and texting all in one platform. This is built out for artists who don't have huge teams and don't want to get overwhelmed doing too many things in too many different places. So go to foreverfanmusic.com/no labels, that's no labels with an S, and put in the code NOLABELS02 to get access and try it out for only $1. ForeverFan is your go-to place for your marketing needs as an artist so you can stay organized, have your own infrastructure to make it a lot easier to go to the next level. Again, that's foreverfanmusic.com/no labels and type in the code NOLABELS02 at checkout to get access for only $1. Now back to the episode.
Yo, it's crazy getting into music, bro. Like, you know, I grew up in London, right? And so the person that got me into music, he's one of the biggest producers in the UK. So he went to my high school. His name's Still Bangles, right? And he basically like DJ Khaled with the UK. Like he the biggest, you know, he was a DJ at one point, then he was always making beats. And now he like the biggest essentially producer out of the UK. All the newest talent come through him, you know what I'm saying? And he went to my high school. And so after high school, you know, me and him actually got close. And he's the one that put me onto music and introduced me to like Fruity Loops and that. So before I came to the States, I was working with him, and you know, I was the one that was like building the site and copywriting the music and sending it out. You know, back then, I read this thing where to copyright the music, you would mail the CD to yourself, and you don't open it, the seal. So you do like a certified mail to yourself.
Poor man's copyright, yeah.
Yeah, and you don't remove the seal, so because it's certified. So I was doing that with him back then, mailing the shit back and the certified seal, because, you know, like shit like that, you know, booking gigs. And, you know, they had these things in the UK called daytimers, right? Where I think it was a way of allowing like young people to go to the club in a safe way. You know what I mean? But not at night time.
Oh, wow. That's funny. Right? Yeah.
So we finished high school over there when you're 16. So they set up these daytimers in the city where you'd go to these clubs and you know, there would be basically a club during the day.
Yeah.
Day parties.
You know what I mean? So that was like where, you know, you would be able to kind of like, you'd be 16 years old, but you could still have like that going out type.
Yeah, party experience.
Yeah. Because you leave high school when you're 16. So, you know, you're going into college, still young though. So, yeah, I would like try book gigs, you know, copyright the music, pay for studio time. You know, my uncle, he'd leave for like 6 months out of the year. So we'd be at his crib and making beats on the PC and shit. So on the Fruit Loops. So he taught me how to like use Fruit Loops. And that's when I was like, oh, I'm going to go music school so I can actually learn it. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I moved to the States and I went to Full Set for that reason. But then fast forward, he ends up being the biggest producer in the UK, which is crazy because I was like almost investing time into him too, you know, because I believed in him.
Hey, you got a nice hit rate, man.
There's definitely some L's there in between for sure. There's definitely some L's, you know what I'm saying, that we don't go talk about. But yeah, like, but he was so dope. Like at that time, he was like before his time.
Gotcha. So,
bro, he was already like, he would listen to songs and sample out sounds out the song and throw them into FL and arrange that one sound into the drum pattern. He was doing shit like that in like 2002.
All right.
He was like playing like old records. He showed me like a song that his mom listened to or something. And he was taking sounds from there and throwing them into beats he was making. Like he was doing crazy shit back then. You know what I'm saying? So he was already like set for like greatness, if you ask me, because he was already just so in tune with it. It was a matter of if he was gonna quit.
Right.
That was really gonna determine if he was gonna become, you know, who he could be in music, right? If he quit, then all right, cool. But if he was gonna stay at it, like, it was only a matter of time. And obviously, you know what I'm saying? If you see where he's at now, you know, it shows that he's, you know, he stuck with it.
What I'm wondering, man, right, so, we get a lot of people ask us about music schools, and there's a part of me that can kind of understand going back then because industry was a lot less accessible versus today, where you can kind of like damn near DM anybody or, you know, possibly get a response back. So do you think if you were 16-year-old now, you would still go to Full Sail, or you think you would just feet to the pavement, just hit the ground, grind the DIY way?
That's a tough question. Everyone's at a different starting point, I think, which is the most like key thing. So if you're like brand new out of doing some thing out of your bedroom and you don't really know enough and you don't got resources around you, you know, where they know enough, so you like don't really got anywhere to turn to get what you want to get other than like Googling and finding yourself. You know, school doesn't just like give you information, because you can get the information anywhere. You know, school almost, it's like a personal trainer. It's like going to the gym and having a personal trainer.
Right.
A personal trainer keeps you on track and makes sure you're there every day at a certain time and you're doing scheduling. And so school is your personal trainer, you know what I mean? It's making sure you're in the classroom, you're there at a certain time, you're getting the information, it's testing you on it, right? It's holding you accountable, because otherwise you fail your class, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're one of those people that needs that, you know, where you need to be held accountable, you know, then I would say, yeah, school would probably help, because you're going to be accountable. If you're one of those people where, you know, you could wake up and put 5 hours, 2 hours, 6 hours, some whatever time you have into what you want to do, then maybe you don't need school. Maybe you can do the research. And, you know, I never went to school for marketing. But that's because I was willing to invest so many hours into it. Bro, there was one point I invested so many hours. Like, when I met Joyner, I was antisocial. I wouldn't even talk to people. Because I was spent so much time just focused on a computer. I didn't care about outside shit.
Yeah.
I was like, this is my value right here. Right? And I'm going to put every hour and time out. Instead of an hour, you going out and doing this or whatever. No, I'm putting it right here. You're over there playing computer games. I'm over here. You know what I mean? So it was like, I put so many hours into that thing. I was like almost antisocial at one point. So when I met him, he was like, Phil, I need you to step out a little bit and show me who you were before this. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I was like, I get it. And I mean, it's allowed me to, because I've grown, you know, as the management position with him, I've grown and had to take on more than just that. Now I'm like managing teams and people and content and digital and budgets and royalty payouts and publishing and torrent. It's merchandise. It's so much. I can't just focus on that. But I would say, like, the time that I invested into, you know, learning, like, the workflows and the digital workflows of how to get stuff done, like even setting up an online store and DSP links, it's obviously helped. It hasn't worked against me. It's not like I invested my time into a field that was like dying out.
Yeah.
You know, at the time, which was 2004, I went to school, so I think I graduated like in 2006. So since then, I've been investing into like technology, essentially. And that's worked in my favor, you know, thankfully, you know what I mean? But it worked in my favor.
I mean, like, going back to the transition from marketer to manager, because, you know, just thinking about what I know about marketers, a lot of marketers like the fact that, you know, you're behind the scenes, you don't really have to, you can be antisocial. It's one of those music industry positions where you can get away with being antisocial. And so I'm just wondering, like, what were some of the hardest challenges you had making a transition from that space into being a manager? And then what did becoming a manager ultimately end up teaching you about yourself and your place in the industry?
I think I wasn't passionate about marketing. I was passionate about music first. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And then marketing became the way I got into music. So I understood that was my value, you know? So I was disciplined to it till I knew that, okay, this isn't the only thing now. There's so much more to do. And there's a level of trust built between me and Joyner where he needs me to really overlook everything and not just this one thing, right? And because my passion was already in the music side, I think I naturally just took on the challenges. Yeah. You know, they would check, these were all speed bumps. Like, hey, we're going to face a speed bump. What do we do? How do we do? And it was just, I just stepped into the role and was like, yo, That's literally why I really went to school, to learn about music, not just making music, but like at the time, you know, it was making music, right? Because that's how I thought you get into music.
Yeah.
Right? But if you see, like, before I went to the school, I was already doing the copyright shit by sending mail out, and I was already booking gigs, and I was booking studio time. I was already doing those, so that was always there.
You just wanted to be around it regardless.
Yeah, I just wanted to find my place in it. You know what I mean? I didn't know what my place was going to be in it. You know, it was just a passion thing. I just didn't know how I was going to do it, you know? And then also, like, when I went to school, my mom won a scratch card, like a lottery scratch card. Yeah. So she gave me my school fees through a scratch card.
It's crazy.
You know what I'm saying? So when I went to school, you know, she won £20,000, which was $38,000 at that time. And my school fees were like 37 something.
I know.
So how I went to school was off of that. So that was always like a, you know, you have a little chip on your shoulder. You might have like a older brother that tell you you ain't shit or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So the chip on my shoulder was, man, like, my mom put that on me.
Yeah.
Like, so even if I was doing something else, it didn't feel like, It didn't feel like I was getting the money the way I should, because I had to get it in music because of the investment she put in me. Yeah. And I wanted to show her, like, look what you did. You know what I'm saying? Like, look what you did. You gave me that. Look what I did with it. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that I used that as fuel. I was away from them for a long time. I left when I came to the U.S. I was 18. So I left home when I was 18, 2004. And I saw them once a year, all the way up until probably, like, you know, 5 years ago.
Okay, what was that moment like when you feel like your mom realized that, you know, you really made something out of that degree, that investment she made?
I would always send her stuff, you know, and, oh, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. And she would always be like, oh, that's good, keep going. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When we signed that record deal, I sent her that, and she said, like, congratulations type thing, you know, like, on it. But I don't think she understood what that meant.
Right.
She just knows we did a record deal, which that meant, like, oh, you did it.
What?
And then it was like, oh, but, you know, that doesn't mean, like, we're financially good. That just means, like, you know, we can start working towards that.
We got a shot. Yeah.
You know? Yeah, so I'd say 2018, right as we're 2018, we went to Europe to do a tour, and we sold out the London show, and my brother came. That then it hit. She was like, oh, you guys are really doing this. She was like, you guys are okay. Yeah. Yeah, my brother came to the show. My mom didn't come to the show, but my brother did. And yeah, he was like, yeah, he started crying. It's crazy. Cause yeah, I left home, man. That shit was wild, bro. Like, I left home, left everything I knew. Like, left my brother, my sister. My sister was like, yo, the house was absent without you. Like, you was like a piece to all of it functioning, you know? And then you just disappeared. Like, you know what I mean? So it was a pretty fucked up situation for me, because that was every year that would compound. It would be weight just carrying. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, damn, when am I gonna be able to show them like I did it? You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. So it was just every year it got harder. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think it was like 2019, 2020, I went therapy for it.
Helped a little bit.
You know what I mean? But yeah, you know, I would say 2018.
Yeah.
It hit. My brother was like, he cried and was like, I'm sorry I didn't believe in you. That was his worst. Because, you know, before I left, he was like kind of talking shit, you know? Because he didn't want me to go, I guess. So he didn't know how to say it. So at the time, he was like, oh, you gonna go over there? What you gonna do? You ain't gonna do shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was like talking shit. You know what I mean? So at the time, I think that was his way of like just trying to make me not go.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Kind of like coping with losing.
Yeah, exactly. So like, you know, so when he saw that, he was like, yeah, that hit. And then, you know, my parents got it. And then since then, it's been good, bro. Like, I mean, you know, 2020, I think COVID was hard for everybody, because that was like 2020 hit. And, you know, by then, ADHD gone top 10 Billboard.
Damn.
Right? And it's independent. Right, and we've got a platinum record off there and everything. So we're starting to see the revenue, you know, from the music.
Man.
And so I got myself in a financial position where I'm able to like sponsor my parents to get them their green card, right?
Coach.
And so, but COVID hit. So it was like 19 years of waiting for that moment. And then 2020 hits, COVID happens. We dropped the album in March, so right when COVID happened. So the minute I was financially able to now really sponsor them, and I couldn't do it. So it was 19 years of that, and then boom, that happened. So, you know, it's tough, but they're good now. They've got their paperwork, they're straight, they've been retired, you know, and obviously they get it now.
Yeah, I get it now. Man, I mean, obviously, like, you've been on this journey. I mean, you're talking about like basically 19, 20 years, like you said. Now you have artists that are successful. You have this app that you're working with. Before we get into some of the details around that, I want to know, what do you think separates you as a manager? Because every manager really can lean into their own unique qualities in the music industry. It's not really a set job where, hey, y'all, every manager does X, Y, and Z. What makes you different?
Dedication. Like my, I think my dedication and my commitment to something, you know, something don't go right, I don't quit. You know, I'm there, I'm 10 toes the whole time. You know, so you got managers that believe in moments and they believe in the artist to a certain point, or, you know, they believe in the artist because, you know, they look at it like a flip. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you got industry people that have done this for a long time that have seen a lot. So they got a lot of trauma they carry because they had situations that didn't work out and whatever, whatever. So now when they look at our artists, you know, they look at it like, oh yeah, I'm gonna get them signed there. That's gonna get a deal. That's gonna get me paid. And that's all they're thinking about. They're not thinking about like beyond that, right? And so my thing is like, you know, if I'm gonna put my time into something, like I've already spent all this time trying to build it from ground up, like with everything we've done. So last thing I'm doing is, you know, trying to take from a starving artist type shit. Like the last thing I'm trying to do is flip an artist. Like that's not. It's not even in my DNA.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So commitment and dedication to, like, you know, if I'm going to do something, I'm the type of person, if I say I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it. And then if it don't work out, okay, cool, I'm walking away from it. But if I say I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it. You know what I mean? And so, and I know that commitment is real. And so I'm a little bit more cautious now about how I do that, because, you know, when I did it with Joyner, it was like, cool, that worked out. And then we started helping other artists, you know what I'm saying? Get on and put budgets behind them and things like that. And it didn't work the same. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, I was working and the artists ain't working.
Man.
I was like, you know what I mean? I bought a house with a studio and everything, right? Had two studios in this. Filled it out.
They weren't in there.
There was like, you know what I'm saying? There was like a whole week, like not one record created type shit.
Sheesh.
You know, and I'm like, what am I doing? Like, I'm over here, like with Joyner, like he's calling me at 8 a.m. Yo, listen, I'm thinking this is what we're doing next. So it's that constant, like, we on the same vibration, you know what I'm saying? When it comes to that. A lot of people, it's like, you gotta drag them, you know what I mean? You know, I've seen so many different angles, bro, with the artist thing. I've seen artists that are so talented that they use their talent, you know what I mean, as a finesse. Think about that. That's crazy to me.
All right, let's talk about it.
break that down.
Break that down, man.
Like, they're talented to a point they know they're talented. They know they're dope. They know they're good, really good. And they will use that to lower you in. They will use that to lower you in, to invest in them, to do for them. But their heart ain't in it. They just talented. So that's their finesse. That's how they get the bag. That's how they get you to invest into them and put up for them and whatever, whatever. You know, whether the shit work or not, it's like, well, if it do, great. If it don't, what do I lose?
Yeah.
Right? Like, Joyner's mindset never been that. He's like, this shit working no matter what. Like, no matter what. This is all I got. That's a different mindset. That's not a finesse. He doing this no matter what. You know what I'm saying? So this talent, I've seen every angle, bro. I've seen the artist that's, oh, I just need a shot. Cool. Throw up 250,000, let's go. You sleeping. Smoking weed all day. You ain't trying to work. You know what I'm saying? I've seen every part, bro. full-time job, want to be a producer. Cool, let's make beats. Got placements. Start seeing a little bit. Now you start getting funny style. It's like, I see, bro, it's just too many layers, bro. There's too many layers to the shit, you know what I mean? And so when I started, I didn't sign up to want to be in that, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't sign up for that. You know, my shit came from such an authentic place, like even how I got to do music with how my mother was able to invest in me like that. It came from such an authentic place that now it's like if I don't feel that, then I'm not in it no more. And so at this point, I'm almost like, you know, 100% into Joyner Lucas, because that gave that. And I manage another artist that's super dope. Her name's Isla. And, you know, and she already has like a team built around her that she's been able to, you know, build around her. You know what I'm saying? And so I've been like, I've been a piece to the bit, you know, the other team that she has around her, which works, you know, it works. And so I'm cool with that, you know? And at the same time, it's not like I'm able to put, you know, 100% of the time into that alone, because I'm also managing Joyner. And so it's kind of like a balancing act, you know what I mean? Between the two. But really, I'm really selective right now, man, like with like who I'm managing and why, you know?
So where did coming up with an app come from when you founded that with Joyner?
Yeah, that was, so we was in LA. This is before we signed the deal. And we had rented a convertible Ford Mustang. Mm-hmm. Thought we was the shit, you know what I mean? Didn't realize it wasn't shit. I was driving and he had his phone connected and he was playing beats in the car and he was writing lyrics on another phone. And then he had an iPad and he pressed record where he was recording the idea down as we was driving in the drop top. You know what I'm saying? And I was like, man, we gotta figure out how you could do this like all in one phone, like, you know, in an app or something. And this was like 2015. So that's when we started Tully and we started putting together, like it was literally sketched out. This is the app. Here's the notepad, here's your player, here's the where you import your beat, here's the record button, you know what I'm saying? Here's the rhyming library for the Mr. Miyagi this shit. No. You got away. Got away.
We'll borrow it a bit.
For real. The library, you know what I'm saying? It had a bunch of that type of stuff, you know? And so we just started mapping it out, built it, and he started using it. And that became like the prototype, you know, to be able to play, write, and record a song all in a single screen. And we got two United States utility patents for it as well, because it's all happening at once. It's not like you press record and it goes into a separate screen.
Yeah.
The keyboard just comes out and the equalizer comes in. So it was all in one screen. And so we built that. Rolled it out and had like 40,000 active like users on it, and then we did a deal and got funded with Sony Music to continue building out, you know, workflow for the music business. Like, so it was like they were like, "What's your vision?" I said, "The vision is we've built this for someone like Joyner to create, right, his music, right, and there's hundreds and thousands, if not millions, of other artists that also need to create that right in this same way that he does. So we create this, now we have something." He's the prototype, right? So now we can give it to everybody else, right? But the big vision is that I have to now manage the music that gets created out of what he just created. The master file and the stems and the metadata and the contracts. So I want to expand the product where I can also manage music. So not only create music, pre-production, but once the final recording's done, it comes back into the system and you can manage that entire workflow as well. So from my phone right now, I can pull up any one of Joyner's masters, any one of his stems, clean, explicits, contracts, split sheets, right? Or instantly in seconds for his entire catalog. And you know, our thing was this, right? It was like, if you, you know, record labels haven't built a system like this, right? And it's because they don't want you to have control over your work. Like, you know what I mean? They don't want you to be organized with your split sheets and your royalties and, you know, and why? And when you're a record, when you're an artist and you're signed to a label, you don't own the shit. So why do you care anyway? The label owns it. If someone gets sued, they get sued. If someone makes money, they make money. They just pay you out a royalty, right? So it was like a double-edged sword where like the label didn't care to build the system because they don't care about the transparency, right? And then you got the artist who kind of didn't want the system because they didn't own their stuff, right? And then there was those indie artists that were like, which I saw as the emerging market of, you know, it's growing and growing and growing constantly. And so I'm like, let's create this product for that market, because I think at some point, the labels aren't going to be as positioned as valuable, you know, in this. And artists are going to control their work a lot more. And if they do, we would have had the product where they could do it, right? Until this day, you still can't find a product, a management product on mobile. Go ahead. Let's do it right now. Go on Google, type in music management software.
Music management software. All right. So the number one, well, I don't know if we want to say names, but yeah, ain't no apps popping up for sure.
No apps?
Yeah, no apps. I mean, I see this number one one, but this is a desktop software.
All right, there you go. Desktop software. Go ahead. You know what I'm saying? So on mobile, there's no way of being able to do that. And managers are what? On the go.
On the move all the time.
We're moving around. I'm not always by a computer. You know what I'm saying? Another thing is teams. You have multiple teams. So with the app, you can invite your lawyer, your engineers. You can invite everyone in your team. And you're managing it all like this. And I could be on the go. I could be on the plane, wherever. You know, so it's a little bit early. It's a little bit before its time. And, you know, I think, like, people haven't really understood the full idea of what Tully does as a whole. But that's also because you haven't invested time into it, just like anything, you know? Like, you have to invest time into it to understand it and get to the layers. Even if you took Microsoft Word and gave it to a kid that's never seen it before, they're not going to know how to use it, right? They're going to have to click around and figure it out, you know what I mean? So, you know, and technology is never, like, the artist's first thing they want to do, you know what I mean?
No, not at all.
Yeah, like, you know what I mean? There's nothing attractive about tech, right? So... But yeah, we started that 2015.
What is managing the masters look like in general? Like, just to, I guess, to extract value from the masters, what does that process look like?
All right, so you're gonna have the master recording that you're gonna distribute out, right? And that's where you're gonna collect your royalties from, right? Your music, right? From the DSPs, Apple, Spotify, so forth. And depending on the deals, so if you have a sample, if you have producers, you're gonna probably have some types of payouts or deal structures with those individual people. Mm-hmm. You know, production's getting, it's a very saturated space. It's the Wild West, should I say, right now. With production, you know, people can pull sounds from Splice and not even have to really compose anything. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's I think for producers, it's like a quantity game now, like how much music can they place? Right. Whereas before it was like a quality game, like what can I create, you know? And so the masters have changed a little bit because producers would get paid a lot more before, you know, to produce. I think you've seen people like Timbaland talk about $500,000 for a beat. You know what I'm saying? It's because he was creating something that never existed. He didn't just have like crazy libraries. You know what I'm saying? He didn't have a splice back then. You know what I'm saying? All right. So it's like, you know, It was treated way different. So how you pay out the royalties for the master is a little bit different now than what it was before, right? And like, you're not gonna pay out 40% on a song to a producer. Whereas a producer, you know, back then could have asked for $500,000 and taken a percentage too. You know, some of the production we buy, we'll just do work for hire and pay it out like an independent contractor. You see what I mean?
I know that was awesome.
why not? Like, I mean, because you're not sitting in the studio crafting. You're basically the background soundtrack, and then Joyner's essentially picking the masterpiece that he's going to apply it to. Right? So if he knows he's going to create like a groundbreaking masterpiece, right? Why would he want to give away 10% of that to somebody? Because he's not sitting in the studio with you saying, hey, let's create this masterpiece together.
Right.
Right? He's saying, I can literally put any set. I can go and splice right now. What's the key? A, minor, whatever. Boom. Throw it in. What's the BPM? Cool. Let me find the mood.
Yeah.
You know? And he can craft it. Oh, I like that. Don't like that. And that's kind of what he did with the album, Not Now I'm Busy. He did a lot of that. He's just pulled it together himself. He was able to control the whole sound. You know what I'm saying? And he was less reliant on like producers making his stuff for him.
Got you. Got you. Yeah, that makes a lot more sense. Because, I mean, artists, so this conversation is out there where artists always obviously want their creative value, right? They feel devalued by the industry as a whole, Spotify, labels, et cetera, et cetera. And then when they look at other artists that they work with, sometimes I feel like artists might devalue the other artists around them, right? Producers, graphic designer, et cetera, right? It's like, now you're on that business side, but if I'm not crafting the work with you, like we're really, you're like, you're really producing, it makes more sense. Cause it's like, yeah, I'm just purchasing a beat online. Like I'm just going into the store and getting something off the shelf.
You know? Yeah. And like a lot of producers nowadays, they're making like, you know, they're making like 10 beats a day. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you don't sell that, that sound is going to get dated. And then it becomes invalid. Like you can't even sell it or yeah, use it. Wow. You know what I'm saying? Because like the sound is changing constantly too. So for producers that are making beats, a lot of them is just making a lot of music and they're just putting it out and they're getting mad placements, you know what I mean? And you know, again, that's attributed to technology and resources right now because, like, you know, we've enabled it where somebody don't got to really, you know, play keys. They can play by sound, like, or they could make music by sound. You know, they can go to Splice, hear something they like, boom. You know what I'm saying? Just, you just got to hear it. You know, and now you got the AI shit happening. You know what I'm saying? Which is gonna take shit to a whole nother level. It's gonna practically make the shit for you. You know, you're just gonna set the parameters and the feel and an example and a few reference tracks, and it's gonna spit out 20 versions. And then you're gonna pick which out of the 20 you want. I like that, I like that, I like that. Great, let me put those over here. Now create another one out of that for me. You know what I mean? Like, so, you know, yeah.
I mean, when it comes to the, I mean, business as a whole, man, where do you see this business going in the next, just say, 5 to 10 years, you know, with the AI? I mean, everybody's trying to capture more revenue in terms of independent artists, and there's a lot of ways to do that popping up. Like, how do you see things evolving? Or do you have a hot take that you feel like nobody's, like, touching on just yet?
It's distribution has, like, it's changing dramatically right now. Consumption is lower, you know, it's saturated. I think COVID was a time where people were listening to a lot more music because they didn't, you know, they were at home and stuff, but that's kind of leveled out now. And so if you look at anyone's numbers, they're all lower, every single person across the board, even the biggest superstar. You know what I'm saying? Distribution for music is a commodity at this point. You can get it anywhere. You can go to United Masters, you can go to DistroKid, you can go TuneCore, right? It's everywhere.
Random sites, right? Your main thing.
Exactly. Yeah. And so, you know, Tully's primary focus wasn't to distribute, you know, because it was everywhere anyway.
Yeah.
Like, why build something, you know? And you're competing with these companies that are hundreds of millions of dollars, so it's no point, right? Digital, DSP, Spotify, Apple, and you know, those guys, there's a lot of those too. There's like, what, 200 something stores that distribute just through DistroKid or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's a lot of those too. So if you try to create your own DSP, like an audio Mac or something, it's like, it's hard, right? People are already invested into getting their stuff on Spotify or purchasing the music on iTunes, or they already, that's where they got their collections, you know? So there's a shift that's happening in music, and I'm constantly like digging to try to find it. You know, I don't know yet. Yeah. I think direct to consumer is definitely going to recycle itself now. There's going to be a way to provide a unique experience directly to fan, artist to fan. And, you know, we saw a gist of it with NFTs, right? So there is something that's happening there in that space where it's the direct fan thing that's going to mean something. And I don't know what it is yet. I don't know if it's in Web3 yet, if it's VR, because that's considered direct fan now as well, right? I think the VR space is really interesting. You know, it's not a product that's in every single person's household yet. You know, it's not a primary way to watch a show, right? So, but yeah, music's going through, you know, music goes through a shift every 10 years, if you think about it, right? So when music started, the only way to get it heard was touring, going place to place. Then you had radio, now you can hear it. Then you had television with the music video channels and shit, right? That was your primary way of discovering, right? Then people were consuming the music all along that way through CDs. That was a product that came out of touring, radio, and being able to see it. You can now cassettes and CDs, vinyls, cassette CDs, right? Yep. That went into streaming. And streaming started, what, 2012? Really?
Yeah, somewhere on there. Yeah,
yeah, like the formal, you know, obviously you had the downloads and stuff between
like Spotify.
And yeah, but Spotify, 2012, yeah.
Right, so you was doing CDs prior to that, because when I was, I lived in LA for like 4 years, right? And so when I went to LA, first thing I did was try to find an artist from Compton. For real, that's the first thing I did, because I was like, that's the mecca for an artist, you know what I'm saying? So I went to Compton. I was there like every weekend for like 2 years, and they would just record out of a dope spot, right? And that's still my homie. His name's Chase. He was a part of like the whole Black Wall Street thing back then with Game and MVA. So he was dope. He was a dope artist, you know what I mean? And he was like trying to do his thing. So it was like, boom, I discovered him. And the first thing I did was go get a CD printer. So I went and bought a car, and I negotiated the car price down, like to the price I wanted, but I told him to finance me on the whole amount. So I had an extra like $4,000, yeah, that they gave me back, and I took the $4,000 and went bought a CD printer, right? And you could press up 200 CDs, right? Like, and you just press the button, boom, and it just goes, right? Prints and puts the tracks down.
So you were the one pushing bootlegs or just mixtapes or something like that?
I bought that thinking like, this is how we're gonna get the music out.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, and this was like 2007, eight. So after I went full sale, I went to LA for like, you know what I'm saying? So that was like the CD thing. And then very quickly after, it was streaming. You see what I mean? So every 10 years we're going through a change in music. And so now we're in what, 2024? It's 12 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're right there.
Yeah.
Where there's this new thing that's gonna take place.
For sure.
You know, and I don't know what it is. I mean, I wanna be one of the people that's a part of it somehow, some way, or you know, involved in it, you know? And I'm constantly doing my own, you know, development in it, you know?
Yeah.
It'll be interesting though. I think it's gonna be an interesting take. Where do you think it's gonna go?
I mean, AI is definitely gonna be way bigger than a lot of people make it seem, right? Like, I mean, I mean, even within artist creative, a lot of artists, I say, yeah, I don't like AI, the idea, because it's taking away my creativity. But I see so many artists using it, like, way more than they want to admit, because in the same way you're talking about samples, right, taking up like loops and stuff like that, you go 10 years prior,
right? That's the equivalent of that to those people, right? So AI is just the same thing, a quick fix. You're gonna have the young kids. It's always gonna be the young kids who are just trying to get in, and it's not that big of a deal. They're not beholden to any like purest way of doing stuff.
It's breaking all the rules.
It's gonna break all the rules, yeah.
You think the same thing?
Yeah, I think AI is gonna be the big thing. Actually, I thought VR was gonna be it, especially when the pandemic came and everyone was getting really into the virtual worlds and virtual tours, but it felt like as soon as everybody could hit the road again, it just killed that. And not killed it off, but it feels like there's less interest in it.
It's definitely happening. We're seeing it on the consumption side, on the streaming side, like we're seeing it, you know?
Yeah, real world matters a lot more than people gave it credit for. That we definitely learned that. Last thing, man, a team.
Yeah.
What should an artist be looking for in terms of key parts of their team? Whether it's at y'all at your level now, or you would just want to say like a starter artist kit for team, what they should be looking for, but what are some key pieces?
So if you're starting, I think it's important. Like, I think every artist that you could see that's been successful has kind of had like a right hand, like a left brain, right brain scenario, right? Like, you had the Dr. Dre, Jimmy Iovine, you had the Eminem, you know, Rosenberg, you know what I'm saying? You had the...
Jay-Z, Dame.
You know, you've always seen that, you know? Cole, Eve, you know, you got Savage, Meezy, like you got, you know, Dre, London Post. You know what I mean? And so you see that pattern a lot.
Yeah, you gotta nail that part.
You know, and so I think having someone that believes in you and somebody that gets that you can be to your potential, and you as an artist knowing what your potential is. So if you're not the artist that's gonna sell out, you know, 10,000s and you're at that place where you're like, I don't think I'll be able to do that, but I could do this, it's fine. There's nothing wrong in it. But just like knowing what your potential is and then finding somebody who actually believes in you more than you believe in yourself. Because you as an artist might be like, yo, I might be able to do 4,000s and that's all I need. But there's going to be someone looking at you like, nah, you're going to sell 10,000 rooms everywhere we go. You know, you're going to have millions of fans, not hundreds of thousands of fans. You know, so you want to find that manager that believes in you almost more than you believe in yourself. Sometimes, you know, I really believed in Joyner, like wholeheartedly.
I mean, that makes a lot of sense, especially as hard as it gets.
Yeah, like, you know what I'm saying? So I think that's like the key thing. And not everyone needs a manager right away, because you got to also prove your worth to somebody to think that. Like, nobody's just going to say, I believe in you more than anything I believe in my life, unless you're putting the work in. Putting music out, dropping videos, social proof, like showing like you have something. That's the only way someone's gonna take that first step where they're like, I really believe in you. Right. To even feel that, right? Joyner was already doing that. I saw the video, I saw the audio, I heard the audio, right? I discovered it on Worldstar. So it was like, he was already doing those elements for me to be like, yo, I can believe in this. And then as I believed in it, I was like, no, I really believe in this. You know what I'm saying? Like. So I think like that's the first thing as an artist. Like, you gotta be doing that to get someone to believe and attract that into your life. And then once you got that, now you got that yin yang shit going on where, you know, you can figure out the next steps you need. You know what I mean? But you can't do it by yourself.
What's the blueprint on what an artist should be focused on now?
Like a new artist, like someone early, trying to get on?
Like a brand new artist.
Their first start.
Yeah, things might change in a year or whatever, but like, what should they be focused on today?
All right. Fastest way you're gonna gain fans and audience is on social. Find one platform that you can grow on. One. Like, you're gonna use all of them, I get it. They're all like experimental grounds to try to figure stuff out, but figure out how to make it work on one. Because it's so hard to get one thing to work.
Yep.
It's like the hardest thing. So if you can get one thing to work, you've already cracked the code, right? And then you got to double, triple down on that one thing that works. So ours was Facebook. That was the one thing that we got to work. And we got that to like a million, and then we got the you know, the snowball effect from it. You know what I mean? So find that platform. And right now, I think obviously TikTok is like a platform. It's very saturated, but that's a platform that, you know, could work. And then YouTube Shorts. Right now, that's the thing. It won't be the thing forever, but right now it is. And so, and then be early on the next one, you know? So if you're already in cycle of doing it, when the next thing arrives, it won't be a whole job and task to do it. It's easy to just transition your efforts into it, right? But if you're not doing it right now, you're gonna be behind when that next thing happens. So even when you know about the next thing, you're gonna be late because you're gonna be trying to figure out how to do the content, why to do it, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, start doing it now because the platforms are there, and wait for the next wave, you know what I mean? Whether it's a different platform, it might be a feature. That's another thing people should, the artists should be looking for, the different features that roll out on the platforms. Like when Reels first roll out, it's going crazy. So you should have been taking advantage of Reels the whole time. You know what I mean? Yeah. That'd be my go-to advice for artists that's, you know, starting up.
But
all right, far.
That's a perfect place to end it, man. I mean, appreciate you allowing us to pull up. I'm Brandman Sean.
And I'm Kohrey.
This is yet another episode of No Labels Necessary. This is Drew. We out.
Appreciate you for watching. If you like content like this, you'll love seeing our music marketing strategies that we use as an agency to actually blow up artists to millions and even billions of streams that are available for free at nolabelsnecessary.com. And the cool part about it that's going to really make you love it is we don't have to be all entertaining and add all this fluff just to get some views that we do on YouTube. We get straight to the information. There's play-by-play and courses that give you a breakdown of every step that you should do to get success. And you have the ability to have communication with us. We get on live talks, a lot of cool things for members, and it's free just to hop in. So check it out right now at nolabelsnecessary.com.